Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Young Lion, written by Blanche Dalpuget and read by Colin Morgan. Dramatis Personae. Matilda, daughter of Henry I, widow of the Emperor of Germany, wife of Geoffrey, Count of Anjou, the legitimate heir to the English throne. Geoffrey, the Handsome, Count of Anjou, later Duke of Normandy. Henry, the Young Lion, eldest son of Matilda and Geoffrey. Father Bernard, monk, politician, mystic, founder of Chartres Cathedral. Guillaume, illegitimate son of Geoffrey and his concubine, Isabella. Lady Isabella, concubine of Geoffrey. Louis VII, King of France. Eleanor, Duchess of Aquitaine and Queen of France, wife of Louis. Zena, Eleanor's maid. Abbot Suger, Regent of France, monk and politician. Baron Estienne de Sellers, Seneschal of France. Stephen, the usurper, King of England. Eustace, Crown Prince, elder son of Stephen. William, Prince and scholar, uninterested in the crown, younger son of Stephen. Constance, wife of Eustace and sister of King Louis. Elbad, linguist and code breaker for Eustace. Henry Blois, Bishop of Winchester, brother of Stephen, politician, second wealthiest man in England after the king. Theobald, Archbishop of Canterbury. Geoffrey the Younger, second son of Geoffrey and Matilda. William, youngest son of Geoffrey and Matilda. Douglas, Highland warrior and shaman. David, King of Scotland. Earl Ranulph, English magnate, supporter of King David. Lady Edith Walter, supporter of King David. Sir William Walter, husband of Lady Edith. Baron Robert de Cholet, friend of Geoffrey the Handsome. Erasmus, Greek philosopher and physician to Eleanor. Bernard de Vendetor, Aquitaine troubadour. Thomas of London, also known as Thomas Becket, Archdeacon of Canterbury. National guardians in the spirit world. St. Denis, guardian of France. St. Andrew, guardian of Scotland. Ancestors. William I, the Conqueror, also known as William the Bastard. William II, Rufus, elder son of William I. Henry I, the Lion, younger son of William I, father of Matilda, grandfather of the Young Lion. Louis VI, the Fat, father of Louis VII. Fulke, the Black, Count of Anjou, ancestor of Geoffrey the Handsome. Melusine, a witch, ancestress of the Count of Anjou. La Dangereuse, grandmother of Eleanor, later her stepmother, said to be a sorceress. William IX, Duke of Aquitaine, troubadour, father of Eleanor. Animals. Bastet and Sekhmet, Eleanor's cats. Hambril, Matilda's pet monkey. Jason, King Louis's Arabian stallion. Selima, Eleanor's Arabian mare. Princess, Eleanor's falcon. Prologue. In the winter of 1149, 2.5 years after leaving for Jerusalem, the humiliated remnants of the army of the Second Crusade traipsed home to the Ile de France. A leaden December sky made spirits sink into deeper gloom. The vanguard was 10 leagues from Paris, but dusk was already upon them. So, the coming night would be spent in the only available accommodation, a monastery. The infantry would pitch tents in fields nearby. The cavalry would sleep in monks' cells. The monarchs in the apartments set aside for the use of bishops. "It's freezing, princess," complained Eleanor, Queen of France, addressing the falcon she carried on her gauntlet. Through the weeks of miserable homeward travel, she'd cast the bird many times each day, whooping with excitement when it brought down a young crane or a duck. She'd schooled her favorite, a maid from Byzantium, in how to swing the lure to call princess from the sky. But this day, there had been no prey and no excitement, just dreary plodding through a grey winter forest. "Absolutely freezing," she muttered. One of her knights offered to return to the sumpter horses and wagon, about an hour away, to fetch her miniver cloak. As he wheeled his steed, a rider slightly to the right of the queen and her knights spurred his mount towards her. Approaching, he dropped the reins, controlling his horse with his knees as he swept from his shoulders a cloak of green wool lined with soft grey badger fur. "Your Highness, please take this," he called. Her knights, men of Aquitaine and Poitou, gave him hard looks, but let him through. The queen passed her falcon to the maid, ripped off her gauntlet and fastened the cloak at her neck. The fur was warm from the man's body and smelt pleasant. "You won't be cold?" she asked. Her tone indicated she did not care if he were.
"I'm never cold, Your Highness."
He gave her a bold white smile and doffed his velvet hat. She noticed that a sprig of broom decorated its brim. "Amusing," she thought. The knights jerked their chins at him, letting him know the audience was over and that he and his manservant, carrying his pennant of yellow leopards on a blue ground, were to fall back, away from the queen. "Find out who he is," Eleanor said to Zina, her maid. She had noticed him 2 weeks earlier, when he had first ridden over from the west to welcome home the army and the king. Many vassals were doing the same. Louis had received most of them in his tent, but there were a few he had refused an audience. Eleanor suspected her cloak-giver to be among the latter. He was vaguely familiar for some scandal. Zina cantered back to the main body of the army, excited to have something to do. Everyone was so bored and miserable, any diversion was welcome. She returned in less than an hour, her face alight with gossip.
"He's Geoffrey Fulk," she announced.
"Ha! The wicked Duke," Eleanor nodded. "I thought I recognised those leopards. He captured Normandy from the English and the Vexin from us. When he came to court to do homage for Normandy, Louis wanted to kick his head." She gave a delicate snort. "Not that my husband would be so undignified."
Glancing at Zina, she added,
"You're wearing an enigmatic face, my lovely. There's something else, isn't there?"
Zina had skills as a beautician, and she could write, unusual for a woman even among the nobility. Eleanor had observed her talents and had pressed the Empress of Byzantium to give her the girl. "I paid a fortune for that little Greek," the Empress had declared. She didn't want to part with her slave's nimble wit and fingers. "Her writing," Eleanor cut her off.
"My dearest, as Christian women, we must allow this poor child to follow her dream to reach Northern Europe and visit the shrine of St. Ursula."
The Empress had heard French courtiers asserting that their queen had the persuasive skills of a bishop and the guile of a cardinal. She had no idea where St. Ursula's shrine was. Neither did Eleanor. She had just invented it.
"The gold you spent buying her, you'll receive in heaven multiplied 1,000-fold, she added, kissing the Empress tenderly.
When she told Zina how she'd freed her, tears of laughter ran down the girl's cheeks.
"Saint who?" she'd squealed.
Now, in the wintry forest, the queen gave her a playfully fierce look. "Tell me what else you have heard about the Duke." Zina had a beautiful broad face, large brown eyes, and skin that, in the hotter months in Outremer, turned the colour of dark honey. Her hair was a mass of black ringlets that she kept beneath a tight veil. Although she was not yet 16,
She knew both Latin and Greek to speak, read, and write, and had already learned French. She hesitated.
You won't be angry.
I'll have you whipped, you wicked child. They both laughed. Over the course of the journey home, the Queen's ladies had spread rumours about Zina. She was a spy. She reported to the Turks. She's bewitched her highness, they whispered. When these stories reached Eleanor, she gave her ladies a tongue-lashing that left them white-faced.
I spoke to one of the milking maids who lay with him, said Zina.
Eleanor flared her small, fine nostrils. The court physician, a Greek from Outremer, had prescribed these special female servants for the king to keep the royal humours in balance. All men who could afford them used milkers.
I am the monarch. I have no need for the offensive practices of my subjects,
Louis had objected.
Nevertheless, Highness, for the blessings of an heir.
That had settled it. Zina continued.
She said the Duke gave her such pleasure. She bit his shoulder so hard the marks of her teeth will stay for a month.
The Queen's expression was both contemptuous and avid. His Majesty's masturbators, as Eleanor called them, were another cause for argument between the King and his wife. How strange, sire, that the physician does not prescribe a similarly unpleasant physic to keep me strong and healthy to produce an heir for France, she had snapped.
You are deliberately unreasonable, lady. You know that men and women differ in their bodily needs.
I know no such thing. I only know that you and the physician assert it. He had stalked away, muttering the Ave Maria to calm himself. But there had been no arguments about the maids or anything else in the past several weeks because the king and queen were not speaking to one another. Since the Pope had forbidden divorce when Eleanor had petitioned him in Tusculum, they had not exchanged a word, not since the night when the Holy Father had tricked them into sleeping in the same bed. Eleanor wrote to her sister, "The Bishop of Rome imagines that one night together can undo 12 years of ill-starred union." When they had departed Tusculum, she had sent Zina to listen for gossip.
"They say that under the Pope's roof, you refused to lie with your husband, and you threw a slipper at him, and his highness wept, saying France would never have an heir. Then you tore his silken sleeping robe with your teeth,"
Zina reported. The queen nodded.
"They say your blood is too close to King Louis's, therefore God has closed your womb to an heir."
It was on the grounds of consanguinity that Eleanor had requested divorce. One daughter in 12 years could not be considered a blessed union. If Louis were to die, there was no heir to inherit France. Wolves from every quarter, from Burgundy, Germany, Flanders, and Normandy, perhaps even from England, would tear the country to pieces. "They're wrong in one respect," Eleanor had replied. "I did lie with my husband that night. I made my body stiff as a plank and glared at him." He had become incompetent, she remembered vividly, and said France would never have an heir. Now she asked, "Which of the masturbators lay with Normandy?" Zina's broad cheeks dimpled.
"I spoke to Alice, your highness, but..."
"So more than one?" Zina reddened.
"All, your highness."
How bold, Eleanor thought. Her grandmother had a favourite saying, "Fortune favours the bold." La Dangereuse, as this great lady was known to the world, had been painted naked on her grandfather's shield.
"She's won me more castles than 100 knights,
he liked to boast. In warm and fragrant Aquitaine, where Eleanor had been born and which she owned, people were not so stuffy nor so in awe of Mother Church as in the north. Louis, at about 20 cavalry, rode up fast behind them. The queen and her party pulled their horses off the roadway beneath the bare branches of the oak forest. The king went by at a canter. As he passed his wife, he gestured with a gloved hand for her to join him so they could arrive at their destination side by side. When her grey Arab drew up alongside the king's black stallion, the mighty beast whinnied softly. He had been bred in Outremer, a a gift from the Emperor of Byzantium.
"What's that rag you're wearing?"
Louis demanded. He knew already from whom she had borrowed the cloak. His men had been watching the Duke of Normandy since he first arrived. Emerging from the forest, the king and queen saw, lined up in front of the monastery, an assembly of monks, black gowns flapping in the cold, all chanting, "Laudamus Deus." Foremost among them, dressed in white and gold, an ermine cape about his stooped shoulders, was Abbot Suger, regent of France while Louis was abroad, and the cleverest man in Europe. He alternately clasped his hands and flung them apart in welcome to his earthly ruler. Four young monks swung incense burners in the wintry air. Perfumed smoke seeped through the brass fretwork in lazy, fragrant coils, its scent evoking for the queen the glories of Constantinople, here on this cold grey plain outside a city she loathed. "Not quite like the day we left," she said to Louis, as they ambled to a halt before their welcome party. He turned to her to smile, grateful that she was pretending they were on speaking terms. He wondered if, when they dismounted, she would flinch at his touch.
"We have experienced many challenges," he replied.
Challenges, Eleanor thought. Catastrophes was a better word for what had happened since that glorious summer day in 1147, when thousands upon thousands of knights, infantrymen, and ordinary pilgrims had gathered on the plain at Vézelay, red crosses on their white tunics, the nobles' scarlet caparisoned destriers snorting and prancing. Pennants had fluttered on a warm breeze. The queen's retinue of noble ladies, gold-booted Amazons, as they called themselves, had cantered around her. How thrilling an adventure it had seemed back then. Now, the blood and the treasure were spent. The might and morale of the army of the cross was broken. Companions were dead of fevers, war horses of thirst, of hunger, of heat. The pride of Christendom had blown away on the gritty wind of Outremer. "And here am I," thought Eleanor, "the caged queen, thanks to the Pope." She glanced around and smiled to herself. The Cluny monks, our pious sodomites, as she called them, had the miraculous power of being unable to see women. Even the abbot, as he advanced towards her, appeared to be greeting some person who stood just behind her left shoulder.
"Your Highness is even more glorious, if that be possible," he said.
"No satin as smooth as your tongue, father," she replied. For a moment, they looked straight at each other. He was the most intelligent diplomat and strategist alive, but observing his bent back and the shortness of his breath, Eleanor suspected he would not be for much longer. Yet she needed him to live, for Abbot Suger, unlike the Pope, would weigh her marriage against Louis's need for an heir. And such was the abbot's stature, he could sway a college of bishops. Once the bishops of France gave way, so would the Bishop of Rome. "Father," she said, "we fear for the health of your body. Please, do not stand in the cold." Suger loathed the queen.
"Her one virtue," he would say to friends, "is her extraordinary beauty."
More exquisite than an Egyptian cat, he thought. A collector of antiquities, he liked to run his hand along the curves of a gleaming onyx statue of Bastet, goddess of felines, but would sometimes pause and slap its face.
"That's for you, harlot pussy," he'd exclaim.
It became a drollery among the brothers to call each other harlot pussy. The abbot had hoped that in the 2.5 years she had been away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.